Today we're going to be wrapping up our series, Kingdom Come. We're going to be in Luke chapter 19 on page 732, or 733, one of those in the chair Bibles. And you can go ahead and grab one of those, or you can follow along in the Creekside app. This series, the Kingdom of God, has been our topic. And the Kingdom of God is a big topic. And it's impossible to answer every question that we might have. And so we've been looking at category questions. So what? The Kingdom of God. Okay, when? We don't know. How? As we trust the Lord and proclaim his goodness over and over again. Who is it for? It's for the lost. It's for us. And today we're going to talk about the why question. Why? Now, if you've ever spent time with a three-year-old, that why question can be infuriating because it just seems to never end. You're never satisfied with any answer. And I remember when I was a child asking my parents why questions, and they would get to the point where they would just say, because. And that was not a satisfactory answer for me. I couldn't handle it. And so when Kathy and I, we were expecting our first child, Judah, I was remembering all of these things. And I was, you know, before you have kids, you have all kinds of ideals, right? And I was like, you know what, I'm going to answer every why question for my kid. Exactly. And he asked a lot of great questions. Why is the sky blue? Well, I could look that up, sure. Why do dogs bark? I don't know. That's just the way it is. And I found myself saying, because, oh, what happened to me? I got to a point where I just couldn't answer the why question anymore. And how many of us have why questions that we wrestle with, even as adults? We still have the big why questions. And we might come to Jesus in prayer and ask, why is this happening this way? Why is this going on? Why is this relationship so painful? Why is this disease not leaving my body? Why? And sometimes he doesn't really give us a clear answer, right? And today, as Jesus has been talking about the nature of the kingdom of God, he does give us a very clear answer on why the kingdom of God is coming. Why Jesus came. We can know that. And our big idea today is that the kingdom comes to seek, and the kingdom's mission is to seek and save the lost. The kingdom's mission, the why behind the kingdom, is to seek and save the lost. As a church, we take this mission really seriously. And our hope is that we would all live out this mission. And we express this as our mission is helping people discover, trust, and love Jesus Christ. We exist as a church, as followers of Jesus, as individuals to help people discover, trust, and love Jesus. That's why we're here. And so today, as we look at these passages of Scripture, we're going to look at the mission. We're going to look clearly that Jesus is not afraid of hanging out with known scoundrels, but he actually came to go find them. He came to rescue them. And we can take great comfort because all of us are known scoundrels. One of my mentors, when he preaches, he always opens with this, and I'm thinking about stealing it from him. He always says, hello, saints, and the crowd says, hello.
Hello.
Hello, sinners, and the crowd says,
hello.
We're all here. So, and then he gets to it. So let's get to it. Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 1. I'm not going to steal that from him. It did not work well.
You got to train it first.
I'll tell him. No, first time. It's got to work first time every time. All right. Luke 19, starting in verse 1. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached that spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. That Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now, I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, because this man, too, is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. So get us caught up in the story here. Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. And in Jerusalem, he is going to lay his life down. He is going to die as a sacrifice for our sin. And that's what we celebrated during communion, that Jesus obeyed the Lord and trusted the Lord and his plan to rescue us from ourselves. And so Jesus knows what's going on. The crowds are knowing that Jesus is coming, and Jesus has this rumor around him, this reputation that he is a miracle worker, that he has signs of power, that he is a great teacher, and they are longing for a Messiah, a Savior, somebody who will drive out their enemies. And so they are gathering to see him, not just because, oh, Jesus is a good teacher. They're coming because this guy might be the answer to our problems. But their view of their problems were too small. Because Jesus is the answer to the problem. But the bigger problem, the bigger enemy is not Rome. The bigger enemy is sin. And Jesus is going to defeat sin in Jerusalem. He is the Savior that they need. And so Jesus is on his way. The crowds are growing. And there's one guy in this crowd that ironically stands out because he's very tiny. He's a short man, Zacchaeus. A wee little man was he. And if you know that song, don't sing it. And if you don't know that song, you are blessed. But he was short and he wanted to see Jesus. And so what does he do? He does a very undignified thing, and he climbs a tree. This is not something that grown men should do, and even today, if I were to say, you know what, I want to see something, I'm going to go climb that tree and see. People would look at Jason and say, okay, it's time to lock him up in the loony bin, get him the jacket with long sleeves, right? Because it's time, he's just crazy. It's not what we do. But Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus. He was desperate to see Jesus, and he set aside his dignity to see this Jesus guy. As I read this passage, I'm always convicted personally. Would I be willing to humble myself this way? Would I have that kind of desperation to see Jesus that I would do something that where people would say, oh man, you're crazy? Would we have that kind of desperation to see Jesus, to do something that is crazy in the world's eyes? Because we want to see him. We want to encounter him. So Zacchaeus is up the tree. Crowd's coming. And Jesus looks up. Now Zacchaeus is a tax collector. Everybody would have known Zacchaeus. He wasn't just a tax collector. He was chief. He was a known scoundrel. Now why is he a scoundrel? Because tax collectors collected taxes for the Roman government. So they're already working for the enemy. But what's more is they would charge a little extra of their countrymen. Say, you know, you actually need to pay this much. And do you know where that extra would go? Right into Zacchaeus's pockets. Tax collectors were known for ripping off their countrymen. So not only are they traitors, they're thieves. So everybody would have known Zacchaeus, but Jesus has never met this man before. But he looks up and calls him by name. Zacchaeus, knowing his name is one more sign that there's something very special about this Jesus guy. This is the kind of thing that the prophets could do. And here Jesus is calling people out by name that he's never met before. I mean, if somebody didn't, you just called your name out, you would turn around and go, what? Like, am I wanted for something? Like, how do you know me? But Zacchaeus, Jesus doesn't come to convict him. Jesus actually imposes hospitality on this man. Jesus is kind of rude here. Zacchaeus, you know, I was just passing through, but, you know, I'm going to stay at your house. Wow. That's not something that you could just get away with. But here he is saying, you know what, Zacchaeus, I need to stay at your house today. And the crowd freaks out. They mutter. Now, muttering is old-fashioned language for Facebook, okay? Complaining about something. So they're muttering. And Zacchaeus has this wonderful response. Lord, here and now, from this day forward, I give half of everything I own away. And I will pay back people I may have stolen from 4 times the amount. Now, that response is an above and beyond response. There were stipulations in the law in the Old Testament that said, this is, if you rip somebody off, this is how much you need to pay them back. Zacchaeus is going above and beyond because Jesus called him out by name. Jesus looked beyond Zacchaeus' reputation to say, I need to stay in your house. I don't mind being associated with you. Aren't we glad today that Jesus sees beyond our reputations? If you are a guest with us today, if this is your first time, or maybe you've been thinking about coming to church and you've been putting it off because you've been thinking, man, if they only knew my story, they would not want to be with me. If I go into a church, I'm afraid God's going to strike me down. Well, I have great news for you. Jesus sees beyond your reputation. He already knows your story. He already knows what's going on in your life. But he wants to invite himself over anyway. He wants to have a relationship with you. And Jesus' response to this man is a wonderful response. Salvation has come to this man, to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. He's a son of Abraham. You know what that is saying? Zacchaeus, the outsider, the people that his own people said, we don't want anything to do with him. Jesus is saying, you are a part of the family. He's bringing him close to God's family. And the family of God is a family of faith. It's built on faith. And this Abraham guy is a man who we read about in the book of Genesis. And he trusted the Lord. Did he get it right every time? No. He actually made a lot of really big, dumb mistakes. But he learned to trust the Lord. And from then on, his family, we are called to be a family built on faith, on trust. And Zacchaeus encountered Jesus and responded with trusting Jesus, responded with incredible, amazing generosity. You know, from time to time, at Creekside, we talk about living with an open hand, where we say everything we have comes from God, and he can choose to direct how we use and spend and give, all of that stuff. That is God's purview. We just live with an open hand and say, Lord, what would you have me do? And here's Zacchaeus, who had closed fists around other people's money, said, I need to open up here and trust the Lord. And he does, above and beyond. And here Jesus explains, the kingdom comes. The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. That's the mission. That's why he came. Zacchaeus is lost. He's rejected by his own people, but Jesus came for him. And Jesus comes for us to rescue us. Because without Jesus, we're all lost. We're all trapped in our sin, in our brokenness. But Jesus sees beyond our brokenness, sees beyond our reputation, and invites himself over to come and be a part of his family. Today, will you trust the Lord? Maybe you're not yet following Jesus. Today is a great day to say yes to him. Today, he's inviting himself over to your house. Will you receive his self-invitation? Will you receive him today? And if that's you, on the back of your Discover card, there's a place where you can mark become a follower of Jesus Christ. And we would love to know if you're making that decision today, because we want to encourage you, we want to give you some next steps, and we want to help you on this journey, and we're all on this journey. After service, we'll have some people available up front that they would love to pray with you. But will you trust the Lord today? Let us know on your Discover card. And at the end of the message, we'll receive these cards. And we'll continue on. But then also, we all know people like Zacchaeus. We all know people who are far from Jesus. And as we are approaching Easter, Resurrection Sunday, we are praying for people who are far from Jesus. And I want to invite you to be praying for people, three people at least three people, who are far from Jesus, and to pray for them for 1 minute each at 1 o'clock. Just say, you know, set an alarm on your phone, on your watch, whatever, and say, Lord, I want to pray for these people and look for opportunities to share the hope that I have in Jesus. Invite them to come to church with you. Invite them into your community group. Invite them to be in relationship with you and with Jesus. Will you write down their names on your Discover card so we can be praying with you over the coming weeks? Because we are eagerly anticipating our friends, our family members, our loved ones. We're longing for the day when they will trust Jesus and have that same response when they encounter Jesus that Zacchaeus did. Lord, I'm all yours. I'm all yours. Will you trust him today with these people? Will you be praying with them? Because Jesus came to seek and save the lost. And that's actually our memory verse this week. If from time to time we like to memorize scripture and hide those commands and the promises of God in our minds and in our hearts so that when we face difficulty, when we need to be reminded, we can call upon these truths of the Bible and say, the mission of God, the kingdom comes. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Will you memorize that with us this week? And keep that close with you. We're going to respond in the message in a little bit, but we have one more section that I want to talk about today. And this is a passage that has a parallel passage in the other Gospels. You might have heard this same parable called the parable of the talents. And today we're going to talk about the parable of the minas. A talent and a mina is an increment of money. And both of them are about 100 days' wages. So it's a lot of money. All right, so I'm going to read this entire parable, and then we'll talk a little bit about it and how this has been shaping our church and maybe shaping our future as a church as well. And so let's look at verse 11. While they were listening to this, he went on to tell them a parable because he was near Jerusalem, and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. He said, a man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. So he called 10 of his servants and gave them 10 minas. Put this money to work, he said, until I come back. But his subjects hated him and sent a delegation after him to say, we don't want this man to be our king. He was made king, however, and returned home. Then he sent for the servants to whom he had given the money in order to find out what they had gained with it. The first one came and said, sir, your mina has earned 10 more. Well done, my good servant, his master replied, because you have been trustworthy in a very small matter, take charge of 10 cities. The second came and said, sir, your mina has earned 5 more. The master answered, you take charge of 5 cities. Then another servant came and said, sir, here is your mina. I've kept it laid away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you are a hard man. You take out what you did not put in and you reap what you did not sow. His master replied, I will judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew, did you, that I am a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow? Why then didn't you put my money on deposit so that when I came back, I could have collected it with interest? Then he said to those standing by, take his mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. Sir, they said, he already has 10. He replied, I tell you, that to everyone who has, more will be given, but as for the one who has nothing, even what they have will be taken away. But those enemies of mine who did not want me to be king over them, bring them here and kill them in front of me. Let's pray. It's a weird end, right? I was like, what is happening there? We're not going to spend a lot of time on that one. All right, the end there. Just a heads up. It's weird. And this is an interesting parable. Parables are a story with a purpose. And so what is the purpose behind this story? Here, Jesus is talking to Zacchaeus, who is taking his resources, honest or dishonest resources, and saying, I'm going to start giving these away, above and beyond. I'm going to give it away. And the people are muttering that Jesus would be with him, and so Jesus is telling the crowd, look, there is a coming king. Jesus is that king. People will want to reject him. Jesus will be rejected. But he will come back. And in the meantime, the master, he gave his servants a job. Put these resources to work. Put these resources to work. And so, some of the subjects, they go and they just protest. But three remain, and one multiplies that one mina into 10 minas. That's a significant increase, right? And he's rewarded wonderfully. And then another one takes one and multiplies it into five. Again, rewarded wonderfully. And then that one guy, he takes the one and he puts it in a cloth. In the parable of the talents, that guy, he actually buries it, which seems a little bit more secure than putting it in a cloth. It's kind of like a kid hiding behind the curtains, like, you know, I can't see you. Like, yeah, I can see your feet, you know, and like, it's not even that secure. But he's like, I put it under my tablecloth. And people said, what's wrong with your table? And I said, nothing, don't ask. But he was afraid. He was afraid of his master. He didn't want to lose it. You know, the other two, like, they invested those resources. And anytime you invest resources, it takes risk. Because they could have lost that mina and they could have been disciplined. But they looked beyond the fear to say, look, you know what, I need to do this thing that the master wanted me to do. I'm going to put this money to work. And they did. But the one was afraid. This parable reminds us today that fear is not an appropriate response to the master's commands. Jesus will call us to do all kinds of things. Things that we don't necessarily even like to do. Things that we would never choose to do for ourselves. Things that we never planned on. But he calls us to trust him. And fear is no excuse. And sometimes we might be afraid, but we need to do it anyway. I was listening to a podcast this week, and the person was talking about goal setting. And he said, you know, sometimes you got to set goals that are scary. But you got to do it scared anyway. Because that's the goal. And any time that we trust the Lord, we're stepping out. And say, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to put my foot on here. But we're trusting the Lord. Fear is not an appropriate response to the master's commands. Now, this parable has been a part of my journey and my heart. I've been wrestling with this for a good long while. In 2015, I drove onto a campus on Sunday morning. I usually park up there in the basketball court. And I felt the Spirit impress on my heart, you're burying your talents in the ground. And I looked up at the hill, and I was like, you know what? We have no vision to build on this hill. We have no vision to expand. Like, my heart is to multiply. I don't want to see bigger churches. I want to see more churches. And so I began to pray, Lord, is that what you're challenging us to do? Is to let go of these 5 acres up here? And so we began to investigate if there was a developer who was interested, and there was, Sunquist Homes, and they were interested. They were willing to do the feasibility study. And so we said, oh, let's go for it. And some of you were here on that journey with us. And as they investigated, they were looking at a house to buy to turn it into a road. And they discovered that this neighborhood has a covenant. So all these houses around our property have to be houses forever, basically. And so Sunquist said, trying to break that covenant would be too much, and we can't do that. And so that deal fell through. And I began to wonder, Lord, why did you put that on my heart, that we're burying our talents in the ground? And so I prayed. Prayer is so vital for us as followers of Jesus, as a church, because when we have those why questions, we need to pray. Lord, why? Knowing that as a church, our mission is helping people discover, trust, and love Jesus, and knowing that selling those 5 acres could have unlocked some resources that we could have put into moving the mission forward, and it fell through, why? And my next prayer was, Jesus, help. And over the last year, as we've been talking about our church's finances, the first Sunday of every month, we've been sharing the picture, and there have been some months where it's like, oh, wow, Jesus is providing, and it's encouraging, and some other months where prayed a little longer and a little louder, Jesus help, like that. And it was difficult. And over the last year, I've been kind of in a season of pressure, wrestling with the church finances, knowing that we have a mission to help people discover, trust, and love Jesus, knowing that people are still coming to faith. It has been wonderful to see new people coming and new families getting connected and people getting baptized and all these things happening as we've been in this season of tension financially and still praying, Jesus, help. Why did you put that impression on my spirit that we're burying our talents? And then in November of 2016, Sunquist called me up again, Bob Vick. He's a good dude. And Bob said, hey, Jason, I know our deal to get the 5 acres fell through, but what about if we offered you $7 million for the entire Mount Lake Terrace campus? And I said, I'll tell you what I said, Bob. I won't say no. We'll pray about it. Because I've been praying Jesus help for a good long while. And sometimes when we pray Jesus help, he answers in ways that we don't expect. And he answers in ways that challenge us to say, is this really Jesus coming along and helping us? And so we went to the elders and I told the elders what was going on and we committed to pray about it and we prayed. And at our next elders meeting in December, we authorized Sunquist to do a feasibility study. And they are in the midst of that feasibility study right now. If you look at the field, there's some holes in the ground. It's not because I was looking for those talents, all right? They're doing some soil studies. And so we are in the midst of this. And we don't know what the results of the feasibility study are going to be. But the timing of this passage and this parable that has been a part of my heart, and I've been wrestling with for a year, and the timing of our church's annual business meeting, and I want to answer questions, I want to help process this together, you know, I don't have all the answers yet. But I also don't want to keep this just to us and a few people, but this is our church. And I want us to contribute into this process. Because if we were to sell this land, it's a dramatic change. It's a huge transformation of our church. Instead of being having two buildings and two campuses, you know, we have one building and then we start looking for multiplication opportunities in a different way. But it's a huge change. It changes our staff. It changes our job descriptions. It changes so many things. But what I have learned over the last 12 years that I've been a part of Creekside Church is that my job description is really up to Jesus. And he has changed my job probably 8 times over the last 12 years. And he used Don Ross to do it, and Don's here with us today. But he used Don to change my job description, but I had to get real comfortable with change. And a lot of you were here with us when we sold Northgate and then rented back Northgate for 4 years and moved into here on Easter 2009. So we've been on this journey before. And what we learned in that journey and what we've been learning over this last year is we need to trust Jesus together. And sometimes he calls us to take big risks. Sometimes he calls us to make big changes when we don't know what's going to happen. Because if we knew exactly everything that's going to happen all the time, that would not require faith. You know, sometimes we put out a plan A and we think that's what we're going to do. Somebody laughed. Because you know what I'm giving up for Lent this year? Plan A. Plan A for me never works because it's my plan. And so we need to trust the Lord together. And if we were to do this, yeah, it would be a huge change, but we would be getting some resources out of the ground that we could put into people, that we could put into ministry, to reaching people who are not here yet, to reaching communities that we are not in yet, to be looking for opportunities to reach people who might never come to church on a Sunday, but we can say, you know what? What's going on Tuesday? Is there a way we can reach them in their neighborhood, in their community? I drive by schools. I drive by movie theaters. I drive by community centers. I even go to the library, and I think, why is there no church in here? I drive by so many bars, and they're all empty on Sunday morning. Did you know that? You don't know that because you're here, but they're empty. I'm guessing. They're empty on Sundays. Why aren't there churches in there? Because we don't think about it that way. But there's all kinds of opportunity ahead of us where we could say, Lord, we're going to take these resources and we're going to put them to work. Because Jesus' treasure is not buildings. His treasure is people. And as I have been talking with people who've been a part of Creekside for a long time, people who I know have been praying for me and for our church and sharing with them what's going on, and I wish I could sit down and talk with every single one of you, but I can't do that. But I've been praying and talking with people, and over again, I've been amazed and encouraged. I go into these meetings so nervous. Like, I don't know what's going to happen. They could yell at me. They could say they're going to throw bricks at me. I don't know. And over again, they say, this seems like Jesus is up to something. This could be what we've been praying for. Jesus, help. And it's been encouraging to see that even people who have been so stubborn, they're not in this service, don't worry, who've been willing to say, you know what? The church is not the building. The church is the people. Jesus' treasure is not buildings. Jesus' treasure is people. And the Bible even tells us that God so loved the world, the people, that he gave his son so that all who believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. He was willing to sacrifice, to give, to exchange for people, for us. We are in a moment as a church where we can ask, Lord, is this what you're calling us to sacrifice? This space, this facility for people. Because I want to pursue lost people. And our mission is not helping people build bigger buildings. Our mission is helping people discover, trust, and love Jesus. And so I'm telling you this today for a couple reasons. One, I don't want you to be surprised in April when the feasibility study is over and I say, hey, look, this is going on. I want you to pray about it. I want you to ask questions. And if you have specific questions, there's a couple things you can do. You can write those down on your Discover card if you're thinking about that question right now. Or you can email office@thecreeksidechurch.org. And I want to put together a frequently asked questions list that we can distribute next week. And on Monday night, we'll do our business meeting. We'll do our normal business. We won't have anything to vote on about this on Monday. But I will have a conversation with you and ask questions. And if you are not yet a member, go to 101. It'll be fun. It'll be great. Come to 101. But if you're not a member, you can still come to our business meeting and hear and ask questions and see what's going on. And my hope is that we'll bring more clarity to this. But I also know that I'm not going to be able to answer every single question because there is an element of faith here where we're trusting the Lord together. The other piece of this is it could still be, they could come back and say, you know what, it's not feasible. In which case, I'm going to eat a lot of ice cream. I'll just tell you right now. I'm on a health initiative, but ice cream would be in my future. So please pray. I don't need that. But if this doesn't come through, there are other difficult decisions that we're going to have to make. And we are talking through those, trying to figure out what that would be. But this is one more reminder for us, regardless of what happens, that everything we have to keep in an open hand. To say, Lord, these are your people. Lord, these are your resources. Lord, this is your church and your building, your facility, it's all yours. At any time, you have control. And living with an open hand is a lesson that we all have to learn over and over again because the default position is to start closing our hand around it again. And Jesus wants us to keep our hands open. So will we pray together with open hands to say, Lord, this is all yours. If you're following Jesus today, this is a weird day. I understand that. If you're a guest with us, this is a different kind of day. But my hope is that you would see that we really take this mission of Jesus seriously. That we are willing to give up things that we treasure to say, Lord, if this moves your mission forward, then we want to do that. And if you are a long time part of Creekside and you're wrestling with this too, I understand. If you're like, this is scary, I understand. I've been scared for 4 months. I'll walk with you through this. But we need to learn to live with open hands over and over again. So I'm going to ask us to pray. And we're going to pray right now. And I'm going to ask everybody just to hold their hands open like this. And this is just a physical symbol that we're going to trust the Lord together. So let's pray. Father, thank you for your goodness. Thank you for providing for us as individuals, for providing for us as families. Lord, thank you for providing for your church. Thank you for providing this facility, this property. Lord, thank you for providing the Linwood campus, and we're trusting you with that as well. Lord, it's all yours. And so, Lord, we present to you our open hands and say, whatever we have, it's yours. And so, Lord, we ask for a clear direction. We ask for a clear opportunity on what the next step is. And Lord, we ask that you would use what's in our hands to reach more people, to reach people who are far from you, to reach Zacchaeus's, people who are known scoundrels. Lord, help us to see them, to notice them, to stop looking at our stuff and start looking for them, and to trust you that as we live in your mission, that you'll take care of all the details, that you'll take care of providing, that you'll take care of the big questions. And we need to hold on to that one question. Why did you come? To seek and save the lost. So Lord, send us out to seek and save the lost. For your glory, amen. Amen.